competes in a variety of events against 9 international athletes. The competition produced some very exciting and some very tense moments indeed. The winners were the athletes, but by only 1 point in the very last event. This year, International Rugby Union meets International Association Football in the 1980 Superteams. Welcome you to our annual Super Teams battle, this year featuring the two sides of football, rugby versus soccer. It couldn't be more of an international lineup because the two sides between them contain a staggering 449 full caps. Well, the competition for the Ferguson Trophy is being held at Bracknell Sports Centre and with the help of the Army at nearby Arborfield Garrison. And with me at both sites will be Ron Pickering.
And the teams meet over 9 events, 3 points per event. Many of those events will be familiar to you from Superstars. However, there are some different events. We've got table tennis, we've got a sprint team relay race, and we've got a tug of war. Looking at the teams, I must say, the rugby players are an enormous physical force. They're all giants. But against that, the soccer players have their traditional skills. There should be a lot of fun and a lot of good competition in prospect. So let's meet the teams, and we start with soccer.
Strikers in the game from Spurs in England, Glenn Hoddle. Again from Spurs and a regular member of the Northern Ireland side with 27 caps, Jerry Armstrong. One of the great individual players in the country, captain of Blackburn and captain of the Super Team soccer side, Duncan McKenzie. From Aberdeen to Spurs at a cost of £800,000 and a regular member of the Scottish squad, Steve Archibald. Next, one of our £1 million players from Manchester City and England, Kevin Reeves. From Chelsea, looking forward to his first full England cap, Tommy Langley. One of 3 goalkeepers in the Super Team soccer side from Partick Thistle in Scotland, Alan Ruff. Goalkeeper number 2 is from Wrexham, 37 caps for Wales, Di Davis. And from Chelsea with 14 caps for his country of Yugoslavia, goalkeeper Peter Barotta. And the boss of a side that contains 123 full caps, the manager of West Bromwich Albion, Ron Atkinson.
From the world of rugby, international sprinter and star wing three-quarter for Llanelli in Wales, JJ Williams. Also from Wales, this time from Bridgend, centre three-quarter Steve Fenwick. Wing forward and captain of Ireland, Fergus Slattery. From the same school and university, wing three-quarter Tom Grace. From the west of Scotland, international lock forward, Gordon Brown. And a London Scot with 24 caps as a wing forward, Mike Bigger. Another wing forward, the most capped of all English players with 43 appearances, Tony Neary. Also part of that great Grand Slam team, former England captain, Roger Utley. And now the most capped English number 8 of all time, Andy Ripley.
And the team coach and manager, a man with no fewer than 54 caps for Ireland at fullback, in charge of a difficult team with 326 caps, Tom Kiernan.
So, captains, men and battle plans all set for the first day of this annual Superteams Challenge, starting at the home of the Royal Electrical and Mechanical Engineers at Arbourfield near Reading. Now, the four events here are all team competitions, relying on the overall skill of the two sides. There they are, swimming, cycling, canoeing and shooting. And over the 2 days, some of the competition you'll be seeing is brand new to Superteams.
Well, we're all ready to get underway with our swimming. It's our team relay race, sprinting all the way, and we've got our two team managers with us. Tommy Kiernan first, what about this rugby team of yours?
Well, they're a very well-disciplined lot, and I'm quite happy to manage them with no problems.
That caused a ripple in the audience and not a bit of a laugh from you. Ron Atkinson.
Well, my lads have been absolutely dedicated. In fact, they've trained non-stop for about the last 3.5 minutes, and I think you'll see the effects when they get out in the pool.
Sounds like a great race. Let's get underway and over to Mr. Starter.
Swimmers, please. Take your marks.
Andy Ripley far side, Peter Barotta this side. They swim two lengths, freestyle. So it's England versus Yugoslavia, an outside of sport. England represented by an accountant and Yugoslavia by a commercial artist. And it's Peter Barotta who leads as they come to the turn, and he's swimming well. Paused a little, and Andy Ripley may be pulling just a little bit back now. The first swimmers swim two lengths, and then there's two single swims of one length breaststroke, finishing with two lengths of freestyle. Up they come, Tom Grace and Kevin Reeves waiting to go. In they go, and the soccer players off extremely well. Tom Grace, although going a little ahead on the far side, Tom Grace of Ireland for the rugby players. Kevin Reeves lost a little ground. Tom, a chartered accountant, twice been in Irish superstars, and he's given the rugby players all a 4 metre lead as Tony Neary gets underway, being chased by Tottenham Hotspur's Glenn Hoddle. Tony Neary, nicknamed Nero, probably the best flanker in the game. He's a solicitor. And Glenn Hoddle, about 5 yards down as rugby players get away. And the last two swimmers in, Roger Utley, leading Steve Archibald. Steve got a big gap to make up. Steve from Glasgow, he's a keen fly fisherman, lives in Weir, Hertfordshire, now that he's playing for Spurs. And Roger Utley, there he is, with a good lead. Director of a health clinic in Hemel Hempstead, a physical educationist, well used to this, and he's going to get the points for Rugby Union. Good swim. But Roger Utley brings them home clear. Steve Archibald just making up that gap now. 3 points for a win, remember, and those 3 points go to rugby.
So the football is yet to get off the mark as we come to the second event, and that's the bike race. Now, although there are 3 points on this event, as there are throughout Super Teams, the scoring is slightly different. There are three separate races. There's 1 point for each event. Now, they're riding on a tarmac road through the Arbourfield garrison here. There's quite a curve, a left-hand bend in it from start to finish, which is 500 metres. And because of this bend, the riders are on a staggered start. They're on the start line now for the first race, and it's Fergus Slattery for Rugby Union and Jerry Armstrong for soccer.
Are you ready?
And away they go. The first of the three bike races. Slattery wearing the blue jersey for rugby, not the yellow jersey, as Jerry Armstrong suggested he might be wearing, the cycling tradition. And Jerry Armstrong coming up very fast indeed, and already overtaken Slattery. Armstrong likely to be one of the key members of this soccer side in Super Teams. He's a very good athlete. In fact, he'll be running 400 metres in the relay as well, and really cycling well. That little bit of cycling expertise we're talking about looks to be paying off. Fergus Slattery, well, he's well behind now. Great loose forward, of course, to Lions Tours. Very good soccer player as well, but he's going to lose out to the real soccer player. Jerry Armstrong doesn't know it because he's not at the line yet. Look at him laughing all over his face. There he finishes. That's a good time as well. 44.4 seconds, and no doubt at all who was going to win that one.
And really the key to that, I think, came at the start of the race, because you saw they have a staggered start. That's to account for the bend. There's Armstrong on this side, and watch the way he gets down nice and low now. Obviously he's ridden a bike before, powers ahead there, and he was never in trouble from then on.
One race to go, how's Mike Bigger going to hold out against Tommy Langley?
Well, he's a big, strong boy. Long way, into the wind. He's bald, you know, he's got all the streamlining facilities. He should do very well.
And there's the man we've just had the expert view on, Mike Bigger. 1 point each so far from the cycling. This is the last race.
Are you ready?
So Mike Bigger for rugby union versus Tommy Langley for soccer. Langley, very good young player, joined Chelsea when he was just 15, in fact made the first team when he was 16, now 22, and he's a good sprinter as well. This will be a man to watch when we get on the track at Bracknell Stadium, and Langley has gone ahead. Langley ahead of Mike Bigger. And there's about two or three bike lengths in it as they come round this corner now, and Langley going very well indeed, and it looks like soccer are going to take this one and come out of the cycling 2-1. Langley riding very well indeed, and Mike Bigger there crouched down. And Langley beginning to waver a little bit, and surely he's not going to lose it now, and he's slowed up, and his legs have gone. Langley's legs are all over the place, and Bigger steals it just on the line. Wow, look at that. Langley had it wrapped up, and he lost it.
So that means that the rugby players, having won two of the cycle events, it means that the score moves to 5-1. And the soccer players must be hoping in the next event, canoeing, they can get some of those points back.
Well, they might be hoping to pick up points, but nobody can forget what happened last year in Super Teams when the soccer players took on the athletes. It was in the canoe race that the soccer players, who were the big favourites, got the fright of their lives, and the whole contest changed from that point. Well, that was when they were racing in Canadian Fours. We've got one of those races again here this year, but we've also got two single kayak races. It's a point for each race, like the cycling, and there's been a lot of tactical team switching and selection going on over the last few minutes, but it's finally decided that for rugby, Andy Ripley, and for soccer, Glenn Hoddle, will go in the first race. That's for single kayaks over 125 metres.
Andy Ripley paddles out, looking fairly nonchalant and comfortable. He races Glenn Hoddle over one length, who's not looking quite so comfortable. And everybody's hoping that some are going to get a ducking. David Vine is back at the start line with the competitors who are watching all of this, and there's a real good atmosphere building up.
I think the Titanic had more chance than us.
Roger, now's the time to switch.
That's it, the ATs hold a position steady.
Have this competition very well organised. Andy Ripley and Glenn Hoddle all ready. Frogman in attendance as always. Andy Ripley, Polytechnic Harrier, is an athlete. And as such, he's done everything from 100 metres to a marathon. And look at that start. It's a blistering start. He really is cutting through the water. And Glenn Hoddle, and I suppose he's had much chance to practice canoeing, but this gap is growing all the time as the 6'5" rugby player fairly hurtles along this lake. He's an extraordinary character. Glenn Hoddle really knows he's got problems here. Glenn been with Tottenham Hotspur since leaving school in Harrow, youth player, and now, of course, not only Spurs, but in the England squad as well. As Andy Ripley extends that lead, here he is, chartered accountant, a master's degree in economics, a lecturer at the Sorbonne, and the winner of that race.
Football boat forward slightly. Well, steady there. Are you ready?
And they get away. Jerry Armstrong's boat's rocking just a little bit. That's smoother from Roger Utley, and he's got the better start. Where these rugby players get time to practice canoeing, but they look very good. Now that's a bit short arm from Jerry Armstrong. He needs a long straight arm so that he can dip that paddle cleanly in, and Roger Utley's got the better style and he's getting the better stroke. And there's a bit of correction. So Jerry Armstrong struggling a bit at the moment. Rugby going away again, and the rest of the team on shore loving this. Another big fella, that gap is growing, 6'4" of Roger Utley. Up to the line, takes it very easy as they cross. J. Jerry Armstrong from Belfast in second place. And the smiles grow on the rugby players' faces.
So Utley waits to laugh because he's not in the four-man rugby crew as the stake boats are moved now to their new positions for the big race up and back. There's the soccer players, McKenzie at the back, where they say shouting will probably come in useful. The two goalkeepers, Davis and Ruff in the middle, Kevin Reeves at the sharp end. Let's take a look at the rugby lineup. They're just about to paddle out. And in fact, they're not as they should be. Is this another tactical change? I see there's a change in the order in the rugby boat again.
What? Change in the order? If there's any order in this boat, it'll be a miracle.
So out they go then, and Mike Bigger is at the back, and Fergus Slattery has taken over the bow position. Tony Neary in second, Steve Fennick in third, and the unmistakable figure of Mike Bigger at the back.
There's relief in those faces that they're not in that boat. It's a miserable wet day, but there's a feeling that they could get wetter. A real study in concentration as the soccer players made their way to the line. Safety boat creeps nearer, and the four-man canoes ready to go.
Rugby players drift back slightly.
Now, how will they organise that? Because their organisation, this is what it's about. Who does what with the paddle when? And they get away rather tentatively. But they're away, and the rugby players get slightly the better start. Fergus Slattery, the auctioneer from Dublin, leads them on, but the soccer players, as Kevin Reeves is, they really are looking quite apprehensive. The most difficult part of this race will be turning around the buoy at the end. And they're not quite sure who paddles on what side of the boat. Mike Bigger, there he is, swapping around. He's got to do the changing, and the rugby player's getting a little bit of rhythm going. Still, the turn is going to be critical. They're actually moving in towards one another. They've gone wide again. The boy coming up. Soccer doing well now. Improved their position. Now a bit of steering required. Mike Bigger just digging that blade in to help them turn, but soccer are doing even better. Taking a slightly smaller bite at the turn. Soccer, if they can straighten up, will have the advantage. A little bit of panic, but they're getting going again.
Come on, sink you.
I think there's quite a few hope that, but rugby now have a deficit to make up. The soccer players got a far better turn in. Kevin Reeves, Di Davis, Alan Ruff and Duncan McKenzie are away. Now the rugby players need that rhythm back. And they're slightly closing now. It's an air of desperation, but they're closing the gap. Halfway back along this course. Soccer doing well. Davis hardly pushing, hoping that they can keep a straight course. But they're still ahead. No doubt that the rugby players are closing the gap, but the finish line coming up. Soccer just holding on. Now the rugby boys really tackling it. Look at it now. The finish line just there. There's only about a meter in it, but soccer have pulled it off. Oh, and away they go. They've gone. Just as everyone hoped. Well, capsized or not, rugby extend their lead to 7-2. Over the soccer players.
And that leaves this Army Centre of Excellence with just one more event to stage for the super teams on day one. The core here, the REMI, is the one which trains and provides the engineers, mechanics and technicians who keep the complex equipment of the modern army working. JJ Williams represented rugby with the rifle, 7-9 and a 6 with his first three shots, and with his fourth at the 9-inch target from 25 metres, aims at the 1-inch bull. And you can't get better than that in the middle. Well, don't waste them indeed, because that meant he'd already beaten his opponent, Jerry Armstrong, who'd had a disappointing five-shot total of 29. JJ not missing out for a chance of a bit of shooting, and a 9, total score of 41. Another point for the rugby team. Well, two more types of shooting still to be held. And for the Sterling automatic that was used on single shot over 15 metres, Steve Archibald for soccer, who'd been excellent in practice, didn't manage to do it on the day. Scored 38 out of 50. His opponent was Mike Bigger, who'd won his cycling and got wet in the canoe circus. He scored 26 with his first three shots. There they are. And another good bullseye. And that meant he only needed a 3 or better to get yet another point for rugby union. Two bowls in a row, 46 out of 50, another point for rugby.
And dress back.
Well, you wouldn't disagree with him, would you?
Unload.
So it was left to soccer's star man on the range to salvage something, Peter Barotta. A 9mm pistol was the third kind of shooting. He was up against Gordon Brown.
Your target in front. Go on.
Comes from Troon in Ayrshire. Used to be a standoff. Now, of course, the big Scottish lock. 9 again. 38 scored with 4. And over to the right, another 9. 47. Excellent shooting.
Markham. 5 shots to score. 10, 10, 9, 9, and 9.
Just 3 short of a maximum. Excellent shooting by Gordon Brown. Deserved congratulations. Peter Barotta.
Ready.
Got something to shoot for now.
5 rounds at your target in front. Go on.
So Gordon Brown watches the man who's got 14 Yugoslavian caps as a goalkeeper. Good shot for the first one. Joined Chelsea in March of 1979. Comes from Belgrade. That's a 9. He's 1 down on Brown at the moment. Good stance. Nine across to the right. Still 1 down on Brown. He had 2 tens and a 9 in his first 3. Oh, it's down the bottom. It's an 8. He can't do it. He can't win. He's blown it with that bad 8 after a good start. And it's another 8 low again. 44. He knows he's lost it and Brown's won it.
And at the end of the first day, and with half the events gone, rugby now leads soccer 10-2.
The second half of the Super Teams, and we're here, as you can see, in Bracknell Sports Centre. There are 5 events left to do. That's table tennis, basketball, the relay, the obstacle course, and the tug of war. And the 2 team managers here are raring to get their lads underway. But I think, Ron Atkinson, your soccer lads have got quite a bit of work to do, haven't they?
Yeah, we've got a lot to make up from yesterday, but we fancy ourselves in a lot of the events today. I mean, we think we did quite well yesterday, but these were, you know, the rugby lads were super yesterday. But we think there's chances for us today.
I remember just before the canoeing, you said if we can win the 4s, then we're right back in business. That's the important part. You won it in some way.
Well, we did, actually, and I fully expected us to do well in the shooting. I mean, in the practice, I think we actually scored more points in practice than they did. But full marks for them. I mean, the fellow Gordon Brown, I mean, I don't know, he's like Wyatt Earp, him, you know.
Tom Keenan, you've obviously got your fellas right under control. I mean, they're doing so well.
Well, they've been very well disciplined, and our preparation has been excellent.
It's discipline, is it?
Yeah, discipline, yeah. And, you know, we've had a number of squad sessions, and they've all come through well, but I did think we might have lost a couple of them in the canoeing race. And once we got through and once I saw them swimming to shore, I felt we were in today just to finish it off.
Well, just to start it off, we had 3 table tennis matches, a doubles and 2 singles. The soccer players back in business with welcome points. They won the doubles in the first singles. Di Davis and Alan Ruff swamped Utley and Brown in the doubles, 21-10. And then Big Andy Ripley lost his singles to Glenn Hoddle. Hoddle always well ahead, in fact, and won 21-12. The third match, another double, in fact, reached the crucial stage, 15-all. Tom Grace and Fergus Slattery at this end, Grace serving, playing Mackenzie and Tommy Langford.
15-16.
Tom Grace serving for Rugby Union. First event of the second day.
16-17.
And certainly the two wins in the other two table tennis matches have put some heart back into the soccer team. Careless shot by Mackenzie, captain of the soccer team.
18-17, Langley.
So 18-17, Tommy Langley for soccer to serve. Of course, really, the soccer players should get good points out of this because it's the sport they play all the time in hotels when they're away on soccer trips.
18.
And you always find they're good table tennis players. First man to 21, remember, or first team to 21.
20-18.
Match point. 20-19. Went for a winner and lost it.
20-19.
If they win it, they get all 3 points out of the table tennis. Yes, they've got it. And that brought the soccer smiles back.
So the footballers win 21-19.
Four events to go, 12 points left, and the big team game next.
There was a tremendous atmosphere for the basketball, which turned out to be a much faster and cleaner game than the game we had last year. Both sides were well organized by their captains and managers, and we can look back on the first half, which was fairly fast and furious, and pick it up when the score was 3-1. Referee very much in command. Rugby playing from right to left. Tony Neary goes for a long ball there and scores a clean 2 points. That makes it 5-1 to rugby. Fast soccer attack. Watch for Tommy Langley on the right here. He too goes for a long shot. That too, clean goal. Very close, very tight. The height of the rugby players, an important factor. There's Duncan Mackenzie coming on. Peter Barotta organising himself. Roger Utley, very experienced. Bigger. Starts another attack. No, he's moved his back foot. And there's Glenn Hoddle, really the star of the first half. Quick with his passing, good on interceptions. Very good in attack. Both teams going for long shots, knowing that rebounds can pay handsome dividends. Watch Roger Utley now. Andy Ripley from outside misses first time, but there's Utley under basket, scores two very good points. 7-3 to rugby. And the rugby players on the bench enjoying it. Andy Ripley, long shot, two more points, 9-3 to the rugby players. And that, in fact, was how the first half finished. And from that, this is how we saw the second half. Hoddle in possession, finds Mackenzie, whips it out to Tommy Langley. Hoddle again, Jerry Armstrong, lovely up and under. Just brought out Tom Grace going for big Gordon Brown, who's come on, and Gordon Brown finds it. Gordon Brown had almost sneaked on the big fella, all 18 stone of him. Steve Archibald coming on for the soccer players, and Duncan Mackenzie goes off. Utley in possession. whips it out to Tony Neary, finds Gordon Brown, goes for basket. Oh! Under basket, Neary whips it out. Andy Ripley's got to keep it in, mustn't go over the centre line. Turns and pivots but travels. Referee Trevor Stripling, quick on the ball, keeping this a very fast moving game. Steve Archibald, his first handling, Tommy Langley, Glenn Hoddle, Jerry Armstrong, good ball, brought out by Neary. Steve Archibald was the one who was pushing. Utley finds Neary, into Utley, under basket, can he turn? Hooks it over the back of his head, scores a remarkable 2 points. Bit of real basketball experience coming out there from Roger Utley, all 6'4" of him. And the score moves on to 13-3. Some more substitute, Tommy Kiernan having words. And Peter Barotta comes on. And Di Davis. Jerry Armstrong going off. And Tommy Langley. Tom Grace on. Gordon Brown. Roger Utley. Andy Ripley. Oh, they've kept their team the same. The soccer players have three goalkeepers on at the same time. Alan Ruff has now joined Peter Barotta and Di Davis, who dribbles with that ball. Glenn Hoddle intercepts the ball to Utley, makes a very fast break, brilliant! Oh! Side ball. Slow it down, says Andy Ripley to Tony Neary. Gordon Brown does. Oh, and a real piece of contact there. Alan Ruff and Roger Utley. Still very clean, very fast, and very good basketball. Tony Neary. No, still 13-3 to the rugby players who are now in possession. Peter Barotta finds Hoddle. Hoddle brings it forward. Back to Barotta. Shoots. It's intercepted on the way, and another shot from Di Davis. Again, Tom Grace finds it. Neary, Brown, looking for a long pass, finds Ripley. Utley waiting for it on the far side. There's a clear shot for Gordon Brown. Nobody stopped him on the way in. Di Davis, bring it away. Alan Ruff finds Davis. Tom Grace. Ripley looks for Gordon Brown. Great long ball. Hoddle can't intercept it. Up the under basket, and Barotta wrestles it. Wrestles it away from him, and Tom Kiernan can hardly watch. Jerry Armstrong coming back on for the soccer players. Steve Archibald goes off. Andy Ripley, the captain, settling his players down. Tom Grace under basket. 13-3 to rugby. And it's Tom Grace that has three free shots. One count, 14-3. Only two can count, so they can play on this one. And finds it. 15-3, and just over a minute and 10 seconds to go. Rugby players settling it down, but Tom Grace under basket finds Utley. Utley there. Oh. Referee just explaining that those points count. 17-3. The fifth personal foul for Peter Barotta. He has to go off. Duncan McKenzie comes back on. The score 17-3. There are more free shots and there's half a minute to go. Roger Utley, who scored his basket but gets bonus points here. Still the rugby players in possession. Utley again. Oh, Guy Davis to Hoddle. Hoddle on the break. Just touched. And Utley it was that intruded. Soccer players in possession. Glenn Hoddle, who's non-stop running. Into the last 10 seconds. Hoddle, they're counting him down. He must go the basket. Jerry Armstrong. Oh, and time runs out. Game over. Rugby wins 17 points to 3.
Competitive game. We seem to hit a lot of shots go around the ring. A lot of theirs dropped in, and of course those two big giants they got, Ripley and Utley, they're phenomenal.
Your lads got a lot of good attacks going.
Well, from a game, from a competitive game, it's very, very good. We played very well, but we seem to have done that in every event up to yet. But I mean, they're out of order the way they play.
Well, three events are left, 9 points available, and soccer can still do it if they win everything. And more rain in the last hour or so. But as we come outside to the Bracknell Stadium track, it's eased off just a little, and the Super Teams competition goes on.
And now for the obstacle course, which is a relay race. We've got the boxes, the benches, we've got the long jump, the climbing ladder, but the problems always occur when they get to this balance beam. It should suit the soccer players, who are lighter and possibly more agile, but it takes a cool nerve. Remember what happened to the athletes, and the pole vaulters in particular, when they came to this event last year.
Two.
But Hooper's off the beam.
Four.
Oh, and he's off again, and precious seconds ticking away. Oh, and this is worse than Lynn Davis in the European Superstars final last year. A disaster, a total disaster for Brian Hooper, and he's been overtaken by Mick Lyons. And Geoffrey Gates cannot watch. And Mick Lyons has just fallen off, otherwise the footballers would have had a very big lead.
And the team's now being briefed. 15 of those astride jumps. And also being warned that it's pretty wet and sticky out there. There's Steve Fenwick ready to go against Peter Barotta.
On your marks.
Leg.
Set.
Oh, and Peter Barotta slipped straight away. It's very slippy out there. Steve Fenwick away onto the parallel bars. Oh, what a marvellous piece of catching up by the goalkeeper. He fairly sped along those parallel bars. Now 15 astride jumps. And that bench top is wet and very slippery. Now the long jump, 12 feet. Both safely over. Climbing wall. Almost level. 15 sit-ups now. Feet fixed. Crowd getting very excited. On they go. Just about together. Oh, Fenwick's been called back. He couldn't have done his 15. Meanwhile, Peter Barotta can't mount that 4-inch beam. Both have problems, and he's off again. Isn't it extraordinary? There must be hundreds and hundreds of little girl gymnasts who are wondering why this causes so many problems, and both are off again. We must go back to the start line, beyond the tape. And then walk the length. Steve Fenwick, meanwhile, has turned his 360 degrees. He's okay. He's got JJ. Oh, and that's a bad fall. And Mike Bigger watches with horror as Steve Archibald and JJ Williams get underway. JJ has done very well. Steve Archibald after him. Just a couple of sit-ups behind. Look. Of course, coming this way, they have the
beam to negotiate before they get terribly tired. It's advantageous going this way. Now the wall. Both save, but JJ Williams setting up a bit of a lead. Steve goes clear on the jump.
Thanks, Fergus. What do you think?
I think it's terrific. I'm getting tired watching these guys.
And Fergus Slattery next to come. JJ. Over goes Archibald and away goes Jerry Armstrong. JJ Williams sent back right at the end there. And Fergus Slattery now has to make up some lost ground. Jerry Armstrong proved to be a very good all-round athlete. There's Fergus Slattery. Jerry Armstrong clear on the jump. Now Soccer back in the lead. There's Duncan McKenzie and Tom Gray still to come. Oh, and Fergus Slattery. I don't think he made that jump. He looked a bit short. But going after his man now. Said he was dreading the sit-ups. Jerry Armstrong quite comfortable. But the dreaded beam to come. Oh, when he's gone about it. Really looked quite dangerous. Slattery totters up. Absolutely and didn't make it. Just couldn't get up on the bit. He's up now. Steadies himself. And it's Armstrong off again. And suddenly rugby have gone back into the lead. And Jerry Armstrong having a disaster. Tom Grace is on his way. The soccer players are groaning, but Tom Grace has negotiated that successfully. And soccer need to win this as Duncan McKenzie comes down. He's done well. They have to win this to stand any chance of this team title. It's Duncan McKenzie's count they're going for. The soccer players have got tremendous support here at Bracknell. Good scoring rate, but Tom Grace is away on the wall, leaps from the top of it. McKenzie, another good all-round athlete. Now the astride jumps. McKenzie going extremely well. Made up a lot of ground, but time is running out. But look at this. McKenzie fairly throwing himself over the benches, but it looks as though the rugby players have got it. That is, of course, unless there are penalty points outstanding. Good run, good race by them. But what does Clive Thomas have to say?
Oh, that was hard. That was really
was
hard.
Was that tough? Duncan, good race. Good race.
Hold on, mate.
We've still got to be talking. There's some penalties to be added on. Some of you didn't make the long jump, but it was a very good race. Didn't the beam sort everybody out again?
Did, unbelievable that.
You were happy, but
yeah.
And Tom, you had a reasonably good beam.
Well, just about. Very dodgy in the middle.
I think it was perhaps easier for me, man. I'm the smallest.
Hang on one sec, we'll wait for the referee to call.
Unfortunately, Fergus Slattery could not jump the 12 feet, and now we have a 5-second penalty against him, and therefore the soccer team have won.
I can't believe it!
Fergus didn't do the jump. He was in between the two yellow lines.
I see.
And I know you are very strict on the laws of the game in rugby, and we've got to keep it on this. And there was a 5-second penalty.
Well, we've got to accept that, I suppose.
That's great. It's typical of rugby.
Thank you very much.
Well done.
Now say what you want to say.
Well, the rugby players have accepted it as well, they might, because referee Clive Thomas was quite right. Watch the takeoff of Fergus Slattery. He's over the line, and indeed he doesn't make the 12-foot jump at the other end either. That means the points are 13-8 to Rugby Union, but it means that football's hopes remain alive as we go to the next event, which is the sprint relay. Now, the track is very wet. It leaves it very difficult to get great speed and purchase on. But the lead-off men, Fergus Slattery for rugby and Steve Archibald, already out on the track. Referee confirms with them what they have to do. first two men in each team run 100 metres. Then they go on to 200 metres, and we finish up eventually with a 400 metres. Steve Archibald drawn on the inside. You have Fergus Slattery in his sights around this first bend, but it really is a quagmire.
Set!
They get off first time, and I must say the soccer players are quite confident of being able to win this one. Steve Archibald going off of Fergus Slattery, 100 metres this first leg. Di Davis waiting to go out for the soccer players. Steve Fenwick for the rugby players. Two good exchanges. And this is another leg over 100 metres. Then it's Tom Grace and Tommy Langley over 200 metres. And it's pretty level pegging at the moment. Tom Grace got the baton, so too has Tommy Langley. No gaps opening up yet. Tom Grace going well. Tommy Langley holding him at the moment. But Tommy Langley possibly losing a bit of form now. Into the home straight. Tom Grace going the better, certainly losing form now. Tommy Langley for the soccer players, and they're losing 3-4 yards as Tony Neary and Duncan McKenzie get ready to go. Now, Duncan McKenzie is quite a good sprinter, and he could make a great deal of difference on this leg, and indeed is doing so already. Tony Neary is really coming back to him at a fast rate of knots, and McKenzie has gone past him. He's made him look as if he's standing still. This is a fine run by McKenzie. And Tony Neary knows he's got problems, but rugby have saved their very fast man for the next 200 metres, and that's JJ Williams, who goes after Kevin Reeves. JJ, of course, ran in the Commonwealth Games for Wales in 1974, and look at this for a blistering burst. And Kevin Reeves knows that he's just after him, and he's going to go sailing past. And that's a brilliant run over 200 metres, and rugby have Andy Ripley on last leg, and the soccer players have Jerry Armstrong, and Jerry Armstrong can sprint too. Now, if he keeps a cool head, closes that gap on Andy Ripley and stays there as long as possible and tries to steal it just short of the line, he stands a chance. Ripley, of course, a most experienced runner, over 400 metres and 400 metres hurdles, and they've both slowed it down very nicely. Now, Armstrong's gone, but has he gone too soon? He's opened up a gap, but I think he's played into the hands of the big man. He should have waited, and now he's got to run the whole of this bend with Ripley just behind him, and indeed he's moved out and let the big man through on the inside. And Jerry Armstrong, good sprinter that he is, finds the experience of Ripley coming through on the inside, and this means that rugby are going to win this one and win the overall team title. A fine race and a good win for the rugby players.
What a good race, though, throughout. Must have thought you were in with a chance.
It was topsy-turvy. Our lads went in front, and then one of their lads went in front, and I was only a few yards down. I was happy at the death. I thought I could make it up.
Yeah.
But he came back strong at the face.
Big smile on the face.
It was their tactics, you know, unbelievable. Keep everybody
up. What about Tony Neary's tactics?
Full sense of security.
Tom Kent on the racks.
Good job, JJ showed some of his old form there.
We work on good sir, and then he lets him pass him.
Good one. Anyway, well done, the rugby players. Three more points on the board.
Thanks, Rob. Thanks.
And those 3 points stitched it up for the rugby men. They couldn't lose because there was only one event to go. That was the traditional Super Teams tug of war, 3 pulls in all. Soccer won the first and won it very quickly in less than 10 seconds. Rugby took the second, and here's what happened in the third and final pull, the last event of Super Teams. £1,500 weight limit on the rope. Rugby had to leave out Ripley and Tom Grace. Soccer only had to leave out Duncan McKenzie. Pretty hefty side bets going around, I can tell you, on this last event.
John Keenan, get your team going.
And the soccer players would love to pull the bigger rugby men, and Ron Atkinson won't let anything go. Unbiased soccer referee,
Carl
Thomas.
Now, are you ready?
And look at the size of the shutters.
Don't pull! Get him rope! Take the strain! Give it a bit. Steady!
Come on now, so, 7 rugby players against 8 soccer men. The weight limit deciding it all. 1 pull each. and you wouldn't think it was all over, would you? 4 meters they've got to pull altogether. Very difficult to get a foothold. JJ Williams going all over the place. They've tried to find the driest piece of ground possible for this tug of war, but my goodness, it's difficult. Tug of war official making sure everything is above board, or as much as it can be with these people involved. And the rugby men, I think, have got them. Are they going? No, not yet. Di Davis on the back, Peter Brody. Yes, they've gone. The soccer team have gone. The rugby men have pulled them. So rugby, 2-1. It's over.
What do you feel about the whole 2 days then?
Well, I just like to make a small presentation.
It's a marvellous on behalf of all of us.
Otherwise, it was a wonderful couple of days.
And what's more, they won 18-9. In the 9 events, the rugby players were whitewashed only, the table tennis and that obstacle wheeler. So it's the banker, the solicitors, the chartered accountants, the business executives, under the strict control of Mr. Tom Kiernan, who take the honours. The Ferguson Superteams Trophy, presented by Mr. Jim Ross, sales director of Ferguson Television, Audio and Video. And out of it all has come a sizeable benefit for charity, with the 9 amateur rugby players all passing on the winnings of £500 a man. Certainly it's been a different type of contest from the one between the athletes and the soccer players last year, when the needle really crept in. But you don't really argue with a team of rugby players built like this, do you? And as for the traditional toast of victory, the rugby team, experts at the art, well, they made a very brave effort to down the lot before their opponents even made the stand. And rugby super team, as you'll see, won the champagne battle in style.